We can have actually two goals in life, depending on our perspective. We can either choose our right to live as long as possible, indefinitely, or we could decide to reduce pain, unnecessary pain and suffering, and indignity and dependency. And if that's the case, if we do want to reduce unnecessary pain and suffering, and indignity and dependency, then we must specify when. If you want to live as long as possible, I will refer you to the eloquent writings of Wesley J. Smith. Barbara will forgive me for using the word eloquent in the same sentence. But, you know, even if you don't agree with his position, you should know what it is so that you can overcome the challenge. And much has been said this morning about the National Right to Life Committee's model law. Take a deep breath. The Starvation and Dehydration of Persons with Disabilities Prevention Act. And if you read that model law, there's one term that's not defined, and that is the word disabilities, and for a number of reasons, which I don't have time to go into this afternoon. And then you may also want to work to repeal on a case-by-case or statewide basis such laws as the Texas Futile Care Law. By the way, care should never be considered futile. Treatment, medical treatment can be, but not care. And that, of course, was signed by then-Governor Bush. And every few months or so, you see in the Texas newspapers how someone is being kicked out of an ICU with 10 days' notice to turn off all life-sustaining treatment because their insurance companies won't pay anymore. To reduce unnecessary pain and suffering and indignity and dependency, you have two categories of patients, those who are competent and those who are not, who need to plan in the future with advanced care planning. And I'm going to touch on what competent patients can do because there are challenges there as well, since we need to learn about that. That should be the easier of the two. And then I'll spend most of my time on the topic assigned, which is in the future for those people who will suffer from dementia. But the choices are sometimes violent or illegal or premature, as opposed to what so many here are working hard for, which is to legalize physician-patient dying. But there's an alternative which is already legal, which is voluntary refusal of food and fluid, and which has been occupied my life for a while in terms of academic and scholarly approaches. There is much evidence that the process is comfortable. The research of Linda Ganzani and her co-workers, the observations of professionals and of families as patients undergo the process, self-reports as the process continues, others' experiments, including my own, and confirmation of biochemical studies. Briefly, hunger is not a problem because the body goes into a biochemical state of ketogenesis. And thirst is a problem, but thirst is treatable by attention to the mouth, symptomatically. So this peaceful alternative to physician hastened dying is legal. But even so, it may be necessary to, if you want to make it ironclad, to write a clear and convincing explanation of your reasons and to appoint a living will advocate, an individual you hope will facilitate your wishes, even though he may or she may not have decision-making authority, and also sign a pulse, which is a physician's order for life-sustaining treatment. And in states other than the half a dozen which have legally, officially authorized pulses, you could write something such as the following and have your physician sign it. My physician has signed a form that communicates my wish to refuse emergency treatment to attempt to sustain my life or to transfer me to an acute care hospital to provide aggressive, potentially curative treatment. Note, all patients die in a state of incompetence, but those times can range from minutes to decades in the case of dementia. People who lapse into unconsciousness after ingesting a lethal dose of medication or who lapse into unconsciousness after a few days of not eating or drinking anything could be subjected to unwanted resuscitation. And one of the people who contributed to the many memoirs in my book wrote this as an excerpt. Recently, I was told that one of my family members, a Catholic priest, had learned that my advance directive contained certain specific stipulations that he felt compelled to fight because, in his opinion, I have an unformed conscience and thus do not have the capacity to make such decisions. The fact that I haven't been a Catholic in 30 years, only see him every 5 years, and that he has zero medical experience are no barriers to his perceived right to assert my autonomy and to impose his, quote, perfectly formed conscience on me. And it gets worse. He alleges that my suffering benefits other souls in purgatory, and that makes him feel morally obligated to fight my expressed wishes. You may appreciate the next poem. Oh, let me help you, said the bird to the fish, as she safely placed him in the branch of her tree. So if we want to do advanced care planning with the goal being so that others will honor your last wishes, we have two choices, a living will and a proxy directive. Living wills have their problems. Well, people who are given the opportunity to create a living will resist the complicated choices. Their decisions may not be applicable when the time comes, and their decisions might not even be stable. They are also subjected to misinterpretation and delays with discussion. There's a story in the book about Yvette that if you dictate your living will, which in California and some other states, if you tell your physician what you want, he writes it in the chart, that becomes a legal document, don't leave his office without having a copy of that. He may be the first patient in his 30-year career ever to ask for that, but you need that, otherwise you could have a lot of trouble. And then there's a sad story of Margaret Furlong, who had a living will, and it was not successful in its goal to prevent the prolongation of her end-of-life pain and suffering in February 2001. Attorneys Kathleen Tucker and the whole organization Compassion and Choices was behind Mrs. Furlong's family attempt to litigate, and that's Furlong versus the Catholic Healthcare West. The point is that a piece of paper, no matter how well it is written, is not self-enforcing. You have to put it in front of the physician, and you have to get the physician to agree to go along with its terms. And that's why I suggest always to have a living will advocate. This is the only example I know where a living will is self-enforcing. We have a piece of paper getting angry and pointing his finger at the physician. And the usual form of a living will, as you know, is if I'm in this condition, then you do this, and if I'm in that condition, then you don't do that. It doesn't work. You need something more than a piece of paper. Margaret Furlong certainly did. So we're going to talk about proxy directives for the rest of the time, the who, what, why, how, and finally the when. What strategies can empower your proxy to prevent the future prolonged indignity and dependency from dementias such as Alzheimer's? And as we go through the discussion, I'm going to touch on proxy directives in general, refusal of food and fluid by the proxy, and the special challenges from dementia and from the President's Council on Bioethics. What are the qualities of an ideal proxy? Well, they should care about you and honoring your end-of-life wishes. They should be able and available when you cannot speak for yourself and decisions need to be made. They are willing to learn about your end-of-life values and treatment preferences from you and from your physician. And they should be trusted to set aside their values and preferences to make decisions based on knowing your values and preferences, which is called the substituted judgment standard of decision-making. They should make the decision that they feel you would make if you were capable of doing so at the time. And it goes on. They should be assertive, articulate, responsive. They should have knowledge of the challenges and workings of the healthcare and legal systems, or at least be sufficiently resourceful to learn what they need to know, for example, to ask an ethics committee or an elder care attorney or a state attorney if needed to consult. And they should have sufficient energy, persistence, diplomacy to vehemently advocate your last wishes. Quite a list. So how do you go about choosing, assuming that you can't get to the ideal? The most important things are to be available, able, and to trust. And many people ask their spouses. A recent paper that will be published in print It's on the internet now as an advanced publication by Michael Lipkin, a colleague of mine, found that 1/3 of married patients do not name their spouses. And there are a number of reasons for that. Spouses may be too emotionally involved, or they may be too burdened by the guilt. And so I am, in my organization, Caring Advocates, beginning a program called Trusting Circles, where groups of people who are finding that their circle of friends and family with whom they can rely on is diminishing as the years go on, and they want to have other backups. They can meet together, talk about the wishes that they want at the end of their lives, and then agree on an individual basis. For instance, in a group of 10, one person might identify two others to be his or her proxy, and vice versa. These groups may need help, some professional support. And Compassionate Choices teaches courses on advanced directives. They provide specialized forms. They scan documents to create wallet-sized cards. But what Caring Advocates wants to do in addition is to be there to help you strategically plan the words, what you precisely want in your documents. And then when the time comes to implement those decisions, and you need some advice or backup or support, we can be there too as well. Funny thing about being a proxy for end-of-life decisions, it is just one of the most awesome jobs in the world. You are asked, do you want to pull the plug or not? Do you want the medical treatment to sustain this person's life or not? And many people find themselves in that capacity, in that role, for the first time. And so it's really comforting to know that they may be able to speak to people who have had experience, which is why client services of Compassionate Choices and what we want to do in Caring Advocates can be so important to them at that time. But designating a proxy, we're now moving from who to what, is not sufficient. We must authorize specific powers and take into consideration the local laws and anticipate legal challenges. We would start off with something like, my proxy knows my wishes from our discussions, and then be specific. And we also need to offer proof. And I prefer to have the proof offered in a separate document called Empowering Statements for My Proxy, and I'll give you some examples of that, or perhaps a private statement. Here's an example of why it's so important to specifically authorize your proxy's powers. In the state of New York in 2005, there was a case called Borenson versus Sunin, and Lee Kahan wrote this in advance directive. I appoint my daughters, my healthcare agent, to make any and all healthcare decisions for me, except to the extent that I state otherwise. And I only want life-sustaining treatment if there is hope. Well, there was no hope, but her sister said she was an Orthodox Jew and wanted to, and the Hebrew medical text does not consider dementia a terminal illness. Three doctors were consulted of NG tubes versus PEG tubes. No doctor was asked whether dementia was a terminal illness. And poor Mrs. Kahan had to be extended in her life with a tube in place for another several months. And that's because she didn't take into consideration the specifics of the law of the state of New York. Let me tell you a related story, if you will forgive my dry sense of humor. A man was walking in the desert, and he had run out of water. And mile after mile after mile, he was looking for a place where he could refresh himself with some water. Finally, in the distance, he sees a tent. He goes to the tent. He yells inside. A man comes out with a turban. He says, do you have any water? I need some water. I'm dying of thirst. The man says, I'm sorry, but we have no water here. But we have a fine selection of silk ties. Take a look inside. They start at $2 for $25. I say, are you nuts? I'm dying of thirst. I don't want a tie. Well, if you're thirsty, just another mile down the road in the desert here, they have water down there. So he rests under a tree, summons the last bit of energy he possibly has, goes to the next tent, yells inside. Out comes a person in a Western-style suit and says, oh, yes, we have water here, but I'm sorry, you cannot come in without a tie. The state of New York does a fairly good job, I have to say, in bold print, of letting its constituents, its citizens, know that unless your agent reasonably knows your wishes about artificial nutrition and hydration, he or she will not be allowed to refuse or to consent to those measures for you. However, it says nothing about the administration of sustenance orally. In fact, it even says if you want a broader authorization, you can use artificial nutrition and hydration, but it doesn't say broadest. Truth in advertising. My feeling is that the word artificial is artificial. What's artificial about nutrition and hydration is not what the stuff is, but how it is administered. And I propose a new term with a new acronym, AANA, for artificially administered nutrition and hydration. I go on and on about that in the book. But there's another story in the book called Poor Mom. She had to endure forced oral feeding, and this is an excerpt. One person held her down and squeezed her cheeks to open her mouth while the other placed some puree deeply in her mouth. After she swallowed, the process was repeated again and again. Of course, the staff here, the assistant nurses, the assistants, were trained to place the food in the very back of the mouth, of the tongue, on the tongue, which stimulates the primitive swallowing reflex. And that is the reflex to prevent food and fluid from getting into the bronchioles and causing pneumonia. It's not a pleasant experience. It's not a feeding that would be enjoyable. I recommend another acronym for doctors to use as they write nutrition orders, which would be APP, as patient permits. And in fact, if you read the Sandra Day O'Connor's opinion in the Nancy Cruzan U.S. Supreme Court of 1990, there is some really wonderful material that could be quoted in support of not force feeding patients, which really is battery. But of course, the skilled nursing facility gets money, keeps the patients alive, and they think, you know, no one's complaining. Here is what you would authorize your proxy to do in this specific area. I authorize my proxy to make all healthcare decisions for me, including decisions to withhold or to withdraw food and fluid, whether administered through any type of tube or line that enters my GI tract or my circulatory system, or by assisted oral feeding by another's hand that requires that I swallow, and to make all decisions regarding withholding all other forms of potentially life-sustaining treatment, except as I stated below. Then, in my suggested proxy directive, I say, you can check one of these if you like, or you can add something else on the blank lines. The first one is, I always want to be provided with food and fluid by another's hand through my mouth, even if I fight my caregivers and I must be physically restrained as they try to feed me. By a show of hands, who would opt for that one in this room? I'm looking. Okay, the next one is, I always want to be provided food and fluid unless doing reduces my pain and suffering, or my body is physically unable to absorb the food and fluid so that they provide no benefit, or I am currently in the process of imminent dying. Who in this room would opt for that one? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's interesting. Okay. That is essentially what Pope John Paul II said in March of 2004 in his allocution for people who are unconscious in the permanent vegetative state. Why do we need to be so clear? Why do we need to explain and give examples? The clearer you are, the more likely others will honor your end-of-life values and preferences, especially if your proxy's decisions are challenged. You should also try to be convincing. By the way, clear and convincing is a legal standard. We'll talk more about that in a minute. Since if there is a conflict, a judge may be the ultimate audience reading your written wishes. Sometimes we think we're being clear, but we're not. Let me give you an example. He says, just so you know, I never want to live in a vegetative state dependent on some machine. So if that ever happens, just unplug me, okay? And she does. So empowering statements for my proxy. The background for this is I have two documents. I have a proxy directive, and I have empowering statements for my proxy because I want to endow my proxy with the ultimate power. He or she, whatever he or she says, decides, that's what happens. They don't compare it to anything that's written. And so what is written can be offered as support, but it's aside from the notarized or witness document. So write down your specific reasons and give examples. Explain why you want your proxies to refuse food and fluid on your behalf, why you have left the decision to your proxy, when, so that they can decide, your proxy decides, when to meet the criteria you fully discussed. Now, sometimes you don't want to put something in a document unless you have to. An example of that would be reams of interview notes or other personal information. Turns out that Terry Schiavo did not go to church for the last year or year and a half of her conscious life. She did not go to confession. She did not take communion. She was not a good Catholic. And if she had written at the age of 25 to her husband that she did not want to continue life if she were ever in a permanent vegetative state, she could have included a private statement about her values and treatment that said, I'm really not that good a Catholic, and this is what I want, and these wishes are durable. Now, she wouldn't want that publicized unless necessary, so that's why it's kept private and used, and the main one is the empowering statements for my proxy. I consider the voluntary refusal of food and fluid as providing a compassionate, humane method for me to avoid prolonged physical, spiritual, and existential suffering. It would reduce the time of emotional suffering by my family members and close friends as they wait for me to pass on. It would limit the bad memories of family members, especially young ones, as I, because otherwise I would descend into further indignity. It would reduce the consumption of the financial resources that my family would have put out, and or for my personal state, or that would be made available to society. And it is not a cruel sentence to die by starvation. It is really dying by dehydration, which is comfortable, and it's my preferred way, and here's another acronym for the medical profession if they want to pick it up, to permit natural dying, PND. I write this statement after I have an opportunity to discuss it with everybody and so on. And I also want to point out that my behavior could be confusing because even if I'm in a vegetative state or end-stage dementia, I may still maintain what's called primitive reflexes. Every time that there's an issue that comes up about whether my proxy is making a decision in my best interest, I want my proxy to decide. So, if I moan while I forgo food and fluids, and an interested party argues that I appear to be suffering, I want my proxy to decide if I should receive only comfort care, including thirst remedies and medications for pain, insomnia, and agitation, rather than to resume administration of food and fluid. And if I seem to enjoy ice chips, because I smile, or if I move my head towards a spray of water, and an interested party argues that I appear to be thirsty, I want my proxy to decide. That's the refrain. Okay? Instead of resuming administrative fluid. And these are in the empowering statements for my proxy. Here are some thirst remedies that are effective, that are available over the counter, which can reduce the symptom of thirst. And they helped me. I became an expert on this subject through personal experimentation. A year ago, July, I went 4 days without food and fluid. My urine output, you know, my being personal, went from over 2,000 to under 200 milliliters a day. And I had no hunger, and I did need these thirst remedies. Okay, and there's a picture of these in the book. Loving caregivers who are watching the process may be feeling honored and participatory in the process if they can help their loved one reduce their discomfort, which wasn't that great. And for very few people really need extra pain medication or, but actually I do in the book for the physicians and others, because sometimes it's the consumer, the client, the patient, the family who has to ask the physician for what they know they want. You may also mention that you don't want to go through the suffering like these people who have been in the news, Terry Schiavo, Nancy Kruzan, Karen Quinlan, Robert Wendland. And then in my own advanced directive, if I have time, I'll tell you a little bit about Margot, the happy demented person, Terry Wallace, and Bob Stern. And of course, you may have had a grandfather or an uncle who had a prolonged dying because no one paid attention to him, he didn't think about it ahead of time, and that would have extra meaning for all the people in your family. Sometimes for people who are demented, the only way to permit natural dying is to refuse food and fluid. Otherwise, you need to wait for months or even years for the next life-threatening illness to come along and then not treat it. Just a note here on terminology. If I'm a competent patient and I want the alternative to physician aid in dying, because I don't happen to live in Oregon, then that's called voluntary refusal of food and fluid. If I authorize a proxy to exercise that option for me in the future, that's called refusing food and fluid by proxy. If my state or country does not recognize proxy directives and I need a living will, then I'm asking my future physician to withhold food and fluid under certain circumstances. But all of these are voluntary in the sense that when a competent person creates an advanced directive, knowing that he or she is predicting a future condition and authorizing for a future decision choice, that is voluntary. Here are some of the criteria that I use for myself and recommend others to consider. Behaviors of advanced dementia. It was mentioned this morning that very few people know, general public, what the minimally conscious state is. In a small survey that I've done myself, even doctors don't know. Nor do they know how important that could be. The first two cases in the book talk about Michael Martin and Robert Wendland, both of whom were in the minimally conscious state, both of whom said they did not want to live prolonged as a vegetable, both of whom the judges said, didn't describe the actual situation that he's in, and they have to continue to live on tube feeding. And this is in spite of the fact that the judges made these decisions before a bunch of neurologists got together to create what's called a consensus opinion about what the minimally conscious state is. And by the way, a consensus opinion is not nearly as good as evidence-based medicine. So all they did was just agree that this seems reasonable. So the judges can do whatever they want. Okay, so here's the behavioral criteria, not diagnostic criteria. If I cannot communicate at all or recognize the people I used to love, if I seem non-responsive to my environment, if I always seem very angry or very depressed, if I am delusional and my behavior is so dangerous that I could hurt myself or others unless I am physically restrained, if I seem to be extremely confused or scared or living in a state of constant horror, if I seem withdrawn, apathetic, or despondent, if I am so totally dependent that I do not even know how to eat or drink, or worse, if I fight those who try to spoon feed me, if I am incontinent of urine and feces or otherwise in a state of indignity and I do not want to linger because I don't want other people to remember me that way, if I seem unaware or unable to appreciate being alive and being cared for while my caregivers are making huge sacrifices on my behalf by ignoring in their own lives enjoyable activities or responsibilities, becoming physically exhausted or mentally depressed and draining their financial resources, this is beyond what I would want. Or if I would prefer my estate, the remainder of my estate, beyond my family needs to help the poor and needy in this country and others, so that we can allocate resources more fairly. So much for the why. How? There's certain general considerations. You may want to exclude certain people and write this in your proxy directive. As I mentioned that just before the bird was placed in the tree, fish tree scenario. If you had a brother like that, you would want to write on your proxy directive, absolutely don't pay attention to this guy. Okay. You also may want to avoid, in general, to delay is to deny. If there's anything that can be, attorneys can get their teeth into, to argue against, you want to preempt that possibility. And what you want to do is, if your goal is to avoid the prolongation of pain and suffering, the prolongation of indignity and dependency, that any delay is a denial of your wishes. So that's why you might say that you want your proxy's current decision to override anything else you may have written. Really not what you have written, it's really how other people interpret what you have written. And finally, which is a pretty extreme extent, after discussing it thoroughly with your attorney, you may wish to waive your right to a court review of your proxy's decisions. And you can always still bring the proxy in if the proxy is not acting in good faith. For instance, if your proxy was to inherit your money and wanted to knock you off earlier than you, and you were still happy, the court would still listen to that even if you had this provision in there. Another approach to the ironclad title that Barbara suggested is acceptance and agreement. I was once at giving a talk in Irvine, California, and after the talk, a woman stood up and said, you know, in the middle of the night, I was called to ask and asked a question by someone on the ICU. It's your decision. Do you plug in the ventilator and keep this person alive or not? If you say no, he's going to die. She did not even know she was named as the proxy. Okay. And what you want to do to increase the ironcladness of your proxy directive is to give your proxy the opportunity to demonstrate that he or she understands and has legal standing. Okay? And the way to do that is to have on this page, which the proxy signs of agreement, signs this two-way agreement, the following, and I put this in a nice big black order. Unless crossed out, I understand that the requesting person, that's you who made the proxy directive, has requested both A and B below. My values and convictions do not prevent me from asking, on behalf of the requesting person, for A, sufficient medication to reduce pain, even if so doing may possibly lead to the unintended side effect of hastening my death. And B, refusal of food and fluid, even by manual assistance through the mouth, if the specific criteria previously described and discussed by the requesting person with me are met in my opinion, as a proxy. And again, redundancy helps. If those A and B aren't crossed out, they stand. Now on to dementia. Dementia is the most. It's an awesome disease. I got very depressed when I first was touched by it. My bookkeeper's grandfather came down with dementia, and she had to move in with him, and I began looking into it. By the way, I learned absolutely nothing about dementia as a psychiatric resident. Nothing. But I will never forget when I was a medical student on neurology and the chairman of the department was walking around on rounds and walked us by would look like an industrial-sized baby crib. It was a hospital bed with iron rods on all sides in which there was an emaciated man in a fetal position. And he said he hasn't moved in months except when he has seizures. This is the end-stage dementia. And then we sat down in his conference room and he said words which I haven't forgotten to this day. And he said, what surprises me is the family still visits when the patient is long gone. Dementia affects most people directly. 47% of people over the age of 85 have dementia. This figure of the number of people in the United States, 4.5 million, is going to triple by 2050 unless a cure is found, even if there is some cure found. It affects most people the most indirectly. If you are a married couple and you have four living parents and in-laws, the chances are 7 out of 8 that one of these four people will have dementia. It's gonna affect us all. It's the most feared disease. This is a recent survey over the age of 55, and as the information sifts down, because many cancers are treatable and pain is treatable, so what's left is cancer. It's the most costly disease when you add back the freely given care by loved ones until they give up. and institutionalize their patients. And for two reasons, it's the most urgent disease, because the earlier diagnosed and treated, the better the prognosis, and advanced care planning must occur before that finite window of competency shuts. And I have interviewed several people who have had mental illness, who have had early stages of dementia, and as long as they can be demonstrably in a mental state where they can demonstrate understanding, some logic and reasoning, to knowing what the consequences of their decisions are, and be consistent about that, then they meet the criteria for decision-making capacity, and they can establish a living will and a proxy directive. I gave a talk in the San Diego area on Sunday, and an 82-year-old woman was brought into me the very next day, Monday, and Friday again I interviewed her, put it all on audio tape, and shipped it out to the attorney, and she's solid now, just in time. She remembered seeing me, but she couldn't remember about why. So her, you know, medium-term memory was gone, but short-term, and I had two witnesses, one of whom was a notary, and we just got that ironclad, just in time. Dementia is also among the most that has the lengthy periods of greatly diminished functioning. As an example, Lisa Winther, in 1985, published these typical behaviors that can last 3 years. Cannot recognize family or self, even in mirror. Loses weight, little capacity for self-care, cannot communicate with words, can put anything in mouth or touch anything, cannot control bladder or bowels, may have seizures, difficulty swallowing, and skin infection. More on what dementia is the most. The most dependency on others, the most devastating for family members, is a high, very high incidence of depression, the most controversial in terms of what do we mean by human life? When is personhood gone? The arguments about abortion, when does life begin? Flip life and with the disease of dementia, when does life really end? And Daniel Callahan proposed setting limits. The most eloquent person I have read about this area in terms of sanctity of life as it applies at the end of life is Professor Ronald Dworkin, who's both a professor of law and philosophy at both NYU and London. And it is the most challenging disease about which we can feel secure that a living will or a proxy directive will be effective. And I could pause there to say that what I think among the greatest tragedies is when a person ends their life prematurely because they cannot feel secure that someone is in the future going to be able to prevent them from having prolonged indignity and dependency. And the two examples in the book, you may be familiar with one of them. Janet Atkins was the very first patient that could walk in, assisted the dying of. 3 days before she died, she played a full set of tennis with her son. Testimony at the trial, she probably had 2 or 3 years more life that could have been pleasurable for her. But she couldn't take the chance that she would slip more rapidly into this dark abyss and then just look at the walls for 10 years being strapped in. The other fellow who's mentioned in the book is a prime example, is the longest serving Supreme Court Justice in the state of Maryland, Judge Robert Hammerman. His mother died of Alzheimer's and two friends, and he shot himself right across the street from the nursing home that he might have been admitted to, again, a few years before he really had to. And to me, that's adding a tragedy to a tragedy. And we need to have in this country and other countries, Netherlands they have it, a social mechanism where people can feel secure that when the time comes, their proxy can be effective, can overcome challenges, and can refuse food and fluid or not treat pneumonia, and so that they don't have this prolonged indignity and dependency. A new challenge, the challenge of the President's Council on Bioethics. I have to thank Barbara for another 2 months of writing and delay in the publication of my book, because this 333-page report has in it the word moral 262 times. Has the word compassion in it 3 times. But what does that mean? Okay. I'm going to give you some quotes from the President's Council. I'm going to show you where the challenge is, and then I'm going to explain how to overcome it. Caring wholeheartedly for a frail patient or disabled loved one is incompatible with thinking that engineering their death is an acceptable therapeutic option. No legal instrument can substitute for wise and loving choices made on the spot when the precise treatment dilemma is clear and care decisions are needed. Proxy directives can appoint decision makers, but only ethical reflection and prudent judgment can guide them at the bedside. Responsible caregivers should not acquiesce in denying the worth of the person entrusted to their care. Competent individuals should resist making a priori negative judgments about the disabled person they might become. What does all that mean? It means that in the council's opinion, it is not moral to make the request to refuse food and fluid and an advance directive, and it is not moral for a proxy to request food and fluid based on that proxy directive, because it would be discrimination against the future disabled friend, demented self. The President's Council assumes that there is a continuity of the body, and Leon Cass, the former chairman who resigned, or maybe, I don't know, he stepped down after the report was published, said the mother that I hugged on the last day of life was the same mother I had hugged my whole life. Yes. And so they say that there's a continuity of the body. But you know what there is not a continuity of? And this one blows my mind. There is not a continuity of the mind. I, competent Stanley Terman, cannot speak for, hopefully 20, 30 years from now, Stanley Terman demented. Although I said I could in Prezan 1990. So the law of our land and the law and the clinical practice of medicine and our common law, throw it all out. What do we have instead? Moral paternalism at its very worst. Here's what it looked like. Here's a woman who's sitting in her umpteenth year in a skilled nursing facility, which we call the Alzheimer's Residence Inn. And the proxy, the loved one, is visited by a representative of the President's Council who has the guidelines with him and says, I'm sorry, the President's Council on Bioethics considers her living will as not moral. Disregarded. Although the committee was stacked with people who believed in that direction, there was one member who I've had a number of discussion with, Janet Rowley, who wrote something that was put in the appendix, and so you have to search for it. The report emphasizes repeatedly that the caregiver's responsibility to the patient here and now, and that advance directives can and should be ignored depending on the situation at the time. So the responsibility is here and now, and the clear message from the report is that if you feel strongly about not living in the decerebrate state defined, where the part of your brain that permits memory, thinking, reasoning, all the things that make you a person still functions, you better kill yourself while you still have control over your fate. And that is the worst tragedy. Another quote from the President's Council says, rationing resources to debilitated or demented persons risks dehumanizing them, might, and use the word, perversely alter the role of the state, making certain therapies illegal across the board for certain classes of patients, rich and poor alike, which would undermine the essential moral foundations of a caring and caregiving society. Well, the poor denied adequate treatment anyway. 45 million people in this country have no insurance, and many millions more have very poor insurance. And so the only people who are really affected are the rich. And concurrently with this President's Council report that came out at the end of September 05, were towards the end of the year, the reconciliation bill for Medicaid, which took away further rights of patients to qualify for skilled nursing facilities. And many people think that Medicaid is insurance. Okay, if I run out of money, at least Medicaid will insure me. Not true. Whatever's spent on Medicaid, after you die, they come and get your spouse's house, and so on. So a bit of So life's greatest irony, to be a little philosophical, I think, is that the freedom to control when we die can, and often does, lead to choosing to live longer. And the experiment in Oregon has proved that over and over again. The greatest tragedies, the greatest insult to the sanctity of life is when people feel that either through illegal or violent means they must end their lives prematurely. What we should do is to promote a culture of extended quality of life for providing people who face dementia with the assurance that their last wishes will be honored. But we need new social mechanisms to be implemented to provide this security, which is what I am trying to do. And I need lots of help. Every month or so, you see another physician being strung up as a criminal for prescribing pain medications to cancer patients because some of those quote-unquote cancer patients sold a few of those drugs on the street. And so there's a fellow in Massachusetts, I believe, 25 years. And they would not let the testimony be entered into court that he prescribed in good faith. So we have challenges. We also have challenges, compassion and caring. A number of people, Alina Cohn, Teresa Connor, Kathy Chimarana, and Catherine Tucker, Merger Watch, are following how many states are considering the implementation of the model law for preventing starvation. Here's how I deal with the moral paternalism of the President's Council report in excerpt. And if you really want to be vigilant, if you really want an ironclad, you have to revise your advance directives every few years as your condition changes and as the political condition changes. While one of my criteria for selecting my proxy is their high morals, I do not want my proxy to judge the morality of my end-of-life decisions. I've already taken that into consideration. And I want them to be durable, and I go on and on about that. And I consider, and I use the same words that the President's report, the engineer, I don't consider engineering the hastening my dying as unacceptable. It is what I want. I prefer to call it permit natural dying. All right, do we have an ironclad strategy or not? We don't. We have to strive for it. In Ohio, you have a choice between a proxy directive and a living will. But if you authorize your proxy directive to refuse food and fluid, it transforms into a living will and requires that two physicians must agree that so doing will not increase your pain and suffering. And they can get a couple of physicians to say yes, and then to delay is to deny. Judges are sometimes accused of legislating from the bench. In the Wendland case, there's a quote that begins, "We find no reason to believe that the legislature intended dot, dot, dot," and then they invoked what was not in the probate code statutes, the higher standard of clear and convincing, which is higher than, more reasonable than not. And I've discussed the what does it really mean with the people who were, the attorneys who were involved with that case, Attorney Nelson and William Colby, who was represented the family of Nancy Cruzan to the Supreme Court. And basically it comes down to clear and convincing is whatever the judge thinks is clear and convincing. And although I have a scientific background and I offered something better, hopefully, but that's just a detail. The point is that what happened in the Wendland case, retroactively, legislating from the bench, and then they looked at all the evidence and they had three people, seven conversations, not clear and convincing, and they ruled that it was did not meet the criteria, because he had died anyway. But it was so important to get that into law that they ruled anyway. As George Filo said, he was the attorney for Terry Schiavo's husband, Michael, to permit endless stays for endless appeals is simply a miscarriage of justice. So when? Again, why me? Why now, if you want to live indefinitely, if you have the funds to do that? You can wait until the behavioral criteria, which I propose, for the indignity of advanced dementia are met, or any other criteria you propose, or you can permit natural dying once pneumonia or life-threatening illness occurs by not treating medically, even if you're happy. The President's Council report goes on and on about a patient named Margot, and who is a happy demented patient. And the question is, well, if she's happy and she gets pneumonia, why would you not treat her? Well, there are lots of reasons. And I put them in an addendum to my advanced directive. Well, because there's no guarantee I'm going to be happy after I'm treated for pneumonia. Because sometimes demented people need to be, they're so disturbed about the transfer and the IVs and so forth that they need to be tied down. But there's a whole bunch of other reasons. But the most compelling one is that, I'll put it this way, is the pleasure derived from my eating applesauce or ice cream worth $100,000 a year when that same amount of money could buy 10,000 mosquito nets that with 40% effectivity can prevent the deaths from malaria of up to 4,000 African children. Now, in an open economy like we have in America, if I save $100,000, it doesn't automatically go to Africa. But the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation are moving in that direction, and there may be ways that we can add this to our social policy. The point is that we won't even be able to think about allocating our scarce financial and medical resources as they become more scarce. And as time progresses, as our population ages, as more and more people have dementia, unless we reach a tipping point in our attitudes and policies before we reach that sinking point in our ability to finance and provide care. So while your personal advanced directive may not by itself save the lives of 4,000 American children, let's recall the sage words of Margaret Mead. Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. Thank you.